Today we're going to talk a little bit about network security options that you have on your Q-SYS system. Q-SYS Designer Software version 8.0 or higher uses a powerful web-based browser tool that allows for simplified core management, known as CoreMan.
CoreMan, who has the ability to adjust network services with a single click.
Oh, I'm sorry. The complete name is CoreMan Azure. But it does give you superhero level powers. Core Manager allows for a lot of granularity in your network security options, especially when you give your core access to Q-SYS cloud services via the internet. Now let's start by setting up our core for safe and secure connectivity to Q-SYS services like Q-SYS Reflect Enterprise Manager. First, let's open up any web browser and enter your core's IP address into the address bar. You can find your device's IP address from its front panel, or if you're already connected, from the top bar in the software. You can use this IP address to access the Core Manager, but before you do that, let's talk briefly about connection protocols. HTTP, or Hypertext Transfer Protocol, is the method by which information is formatted and transmitted on the web. Now, HTTPS is the same protocol, but it is encrypted. The S actually stands for hope. The S stands for secure, obviously. The two different protocols connect using two different ports. HTTP uses port 80, where HTTPS uses 443. More on that later. We recommend that you always use HTTPS protocols when connecting to Q-SYS devices using a browser. However, there are a couple things that you should be aware of, such as this. Wow, that's concerning. Except, actually, it's not. Because I'm connected to a device that I own as part of my infrastructure on the same local network as my computer, in this case, my core processor. I know this web page is accurate and encrypted. In fact, it's more secure than using HTTP, which, ironically, does not prompt these standard web browser warning messages. So, it's okay to bypass this warning and open the connection. By the way, if you ever see this warning while trying to connect to a public website, like your bank, or maybe a website with a superhero fan fiction, you probably definitely shouldn't bypass that warning. If you look at the address bar of the browser, however, you'll notice that the connection is flagged as not secure. But this is not entirely accurate. The core is using what's referred to as a self-signed security certificate, which may sound something about as trustworthy as a dentistry license printed from home. Because the connection is made using an HTTPS designation, it is in fact still encrypted and more secure than a non-encrypted HTTP connection. You can connect to a core using a standard HTTP and avoid these browser warning messages, but you need to understand that those sessions are unencrypted, so inherently less secure. As a result, you really should get into the habit of using the secure HTTPS method when connecting to your core via the browser. Now, let's look at Core Manager. We can see the status of my core, including the model, firmware version, the running design, etc. Today, we're going to focus on three main tabs: users, network services, and network settings. Let's take a look at users first. It's a good idea to protect your core with a username and password. Let's enable access control to create different users and permission levels defining who can edit or access the core. Let's create our first user. The first user created will always be an administrator level user, but you can name the user anything you like. So rather than admin, I'm gonna name mine after someone who should have all the power. And our lawyers are telling me I need to use the full name of Supermanager. And of course, we need a password. Double check it. There. Now that we're all set up, we're going to log into your core using your newly created credentials. Once we're in, we're going to head over to the User tab and set up another user by pressing the New User button. Once again, we can create a username and password, but you'll also notice that we can now assign the user a role. There are three roles available: viewer, technician, and administrator. Our first user was automatically an administrator. An administrator has full unfettered access, including the ability to add, edit, and delete user accounts, and even disable access control entirely. A technician has full read-write access, with the exception of user accounts, which are read-only. I'll create a technician role for a user who needs to make changes, but doesn't have as much power as our admin role. The final role is a viewer. A viewer is essentially a read-only user that can only view all of the settings, except for passwords and pins, and cannot edit anything. The only action that the viewer can perform is to reboot the core from core manager. So let's make a viewer user for somebody who is basically only good for watching. Yes. So that's access control. And it's something that you should really use every time you deploy a core. Note that users with the administrator role can edit other users' passwords. But if you forget the passwords for all users with the administrator role, there's no real way to recover it. So make sure you store it somewhere secure. Remember, with great power comes great... Oh, I'm sorry. I'm told that that's from a different universe, all right? Well, then we'll just move on and talk about networking and IT security. For that, we'll navigate to the network settings page. You'll see that on the Core 110F, we have three sections, LAN A, LAN B, and DNS. LAN A and B represent the network interface ports of the same names on my core. The DNS address and the gateway settings populate automatically from a DHCP server somewhere on the corporate network or are provided by the network administrator. Without a valid gateway and DNS address, you'd be unable to connect to a web address using a fully qualified domain name, or FQDN. In order to use certain cloud services, like software feature license activation, or Q-SYS Reflect Enterprise Manager, your core will need to be able to connect to Q-SYS secure servers via the internet. However, in most deployments, AV equipment tends to be on a dedicated and often not so web-connected subnet. That's where LAN B comes in. Most installers use LAN A for a dedicated AV subnet, and LAN B for the main corporate network or some other network that provides secure web connectivity. So you can take full advantage of those QSC web services. But wait, I hear you cry. Isn't that going to make our friends in IT a little nervous? Don't worry, citizen. We've got that covered, and we'll talk about how to manage that a little later. As you can see, my LAN A connection is a statically assigned IP address and net mask, and does not have a gateway assigned. This is because it is a dedicated subnet with no requirements for a gateway. My LAN B connection, however, in addition to an IP address and netmask, also has a gateway address. This is the pathway for the internet. Another interesting thing to note is that all communications between the core and QSC's cloud services are initiated by the core as a secure outbound connection on port 443. Which, you may remember, is what HTTPS uses. What this means is that, in most cases, no additional network or firewall configuration is needed to allow for full communication between the core and QSC's cloud services. So, now that core can connect to both the dedicated AV subnet and the QSC cloud services via the internet, let's talk about managing those services, running on those network ports. For that, we're going to take a look at the Network Services tab. Here in the Summary tab, we can see two network interfaces on my core, LAN A and LAN B. And for each interface, there are a number of network protocols listed. Each service displays the relevant TCP or UDP port it uses defined in the Protocol Details field. You can see port 80 for HTTP and port 443 for HTTPS, for example, and all of which are currently enabled on both network interfaces. If I click over on the plus symbol for any protocol, I can see which services require this protocol. Q-SYS Discovery Protocols, for instance, is required for device discovery, audio-enabled peripheral and control peripherals, and communicating with TSC3 touch panels. Long story, but those use a slightly different protocol than the other touch panels. If you click on the same plus symbol for the Q-SYS Control Binary Protocol, you'll see a different set of services appear. If you look over here on the right, you can see that we have individual check marks for each of the protocols and services in the expanded view. Let's go into the Management tab and change a few of these settings. as you can see, we're looking at the same information, but from the perspective of the services rather than the underlying protocols. By clicking on the edit button here, you can turn these services on or off individually for each LAN port. Let's say I have some Q-SYS cameras deployed in my design. Obviously, those cameras need to communicate with the core. So we're going to leave that particular service enabled on LAN A, but the core doesn't need to be able to discover Q-SYS cameras on the corporate network, so let's turn that service off on LAN B. Now, I simply hit save, my core updates, and I'm taken back to my summary tab, where I can see that the WSD, which uses port 3702, is disabled on LAN B. If I click on the plus symbol, my expanded view tells me that, yes, this protocol is used for Q-SYS cameras, and that it is enabled on LAN A and disabled on LAN B. That means that the core is no longer advertising or making available any ports or services related to the Q-SYS cameras on LAN B. Note that some protocols are used by multiple services. Look at Q-SYS control binary as an example. In these cases, that protocol, TCP-1700, will remain active until all of those services have been disabled using the management tab. Now, in most cases, you'll want to leave all of the services for your AV LAN, typically LAN A, enabled, unless there are items that you know are not required. But feel free to check with your IT department to confirm that that's okay. How many services you leave enabled on LAN B really depends on the requirements of your project and the network security policies of your corporate network in question. In many scenarios where you simply want to use LAN B for secure communication with QSC's cloud services, you would simply disable all services, leaving only secure HTTPS enabled on LAN B. Note that some services, like VoIP or SNMP, are managed using their own pages outside the network services manager. So you'll want to consult those pages as well when locking down your Q-SYS core for secure deployments. So, now we're equipped to manage secure access to the core, connect that core to QSC's secure web services, and manage all communications on all of the core's LAN ports. Thanks for watching.